too far. Thank you. The work, of course, that I described here was done by students, now not at the university, I'm just talking. The problem that we discuss is the problem of handling video. You may be aware of too much video to read, and there's a clip from a detective elementary.
Right, I think the reduced number of blackmail sent the suspect to the murder, correct? Said you found a couple of thousand hours of footage.
Janet, fortunately, there are no time stamps for records.
What's strange, it'll probably take forever to identify the guests who performed blackmail-worthy acts and intimidating team-working shifts to get through it all. So indeed,
not necessarily.
Okay, so those of you that didn't get the audio because the sound is very weak here, this is an important transcript. There's a couple of thousand hours of footage, and the guys go to meet teams working on shifts to do this. And his helper says, not necessarily, and I wonder whether he's reading our paper. Probably not. But the problem is well known. We have so much media, so much data, looking at this, it's impossible. And examples are terror attack that were all recorded on video. It was in two cases in Europe, and it took weeks to find. All video was there because everything was recorded to begin and to end. But because there's so many cameras and so many videos, it took weeks to find the suspects of the video. In a more recent case in Dubai. This example of video taken there, it also took weeks to find. Everything was recorded in the hotel, in the airport, everything, but to see there, we're talking about weeks. There was a recent event in Boston, and what's very interesting in this event in Boston, that it took 2 or 3 days to find it on video. Everything until then took weeks, and then it went from weeks into days. And what happened? Now, there was a rumor, and I'm just thinking what observed, that Israeli technology may have helped them. So the Israeli technology they refer to is the topic of my talk. We have no idea if this is correct. We have no idea if the technology I'm talking to you was used in Boston or not. The FBI do not disclose investigation technology, but we know that the FBI is using this, so we hope it did help. It's now deployed in places that are more informative, the deployment State of Liberty, deployed the Empire State Building, deployed a lot in China, but the goal is to help sift through many, many hours of detail. So the problem is going on. We have a lot of cameras, we have more cameras, and the cameras have more resolution. There is a much more resolution, you have more bits, and basically all the processing time is a factor of bits. We don't have people to watch all the video, especially when a person falls asleep after 20 minutes of watching such boring video. So the result is that the recorded video is lost video. And those are the community units. It's like put everything, copy everything to slash out. Once you record a video, that's it. You know, no one is ever going to believe it. Unless there's some kind of disaster and then they'll put dozens of people to go for this. But normally, recorded video is disaster. So there's a lot of effort in video understanding, but trying to detect and track objects, trying to classify them, a lot of work done here about that. Recognize the activities, left luggage, street fights, etc. So this is kind of a step towards the direction to understand the video, to automatically understand what happens there, to make it less necessary for people to watch the video, but still a lot of things are left undone. Especially when much of the thing of interest in the video is things that we don't define before. No one knew before 9/11 what to look for the video. Whenever something happens, you always what we call in war, we already fight that we prepare for the previous war, not for the next one. So we don't know what really to look for. That's one thing. And even when we know what to look for, our accuracy is quite small. And most importantly, in video, they say that the picture is worth 1,000 words. Therefore, a video is worth 1,000,000 words. And even if you can detect or find and give some kind of summary in words, in natural languages, this summary is not going to capture the essence of what you see. We cannot describe everything in words. Even there's not enough words to describe all the colors, different colors that you perceive. Not to mention shape and activities, emotions. So seeing is the essential to understand what happened in the video. But the problem with seeing, giving the video to people, is that too much to watch. Even after we rule out most of the irrelevant things using television, what's left is too much to watch. So there's some work of video summary. The most common is keyframes. Keyframes mean we have a video have several million frames, let me take a subset of frames. 10,000 or whatever, but either still images or subclips, take them, select the subframe and show it to the user. What I'll describe here is video synopsis basically object. Let's assume that we have frame, but we don't care about the frame. We have the object, and we want to show the object of interest. And the benefit of using object without carrying much frame is that we can play with time, and you'll see what I mean. So what I describe to you is assumption that object detection and tracking is done. This is the easiest part of video understanding, especially for stationary cameras. Object recognition, activity recognition cannot be done, it's not essential. And we show the results to people that they will do the understanding what goes on. So video synopsis is like what is seen here. It takes a video on the left of a full day video, and it takes all the activity, they extract all the moving objects in this video, and show them simultaneously in 1 minute. So it's a way to browse and to index a video, because as an index, once you select an object, you can go back to the original time. You get a full day in a few minutes. The problem is that events from different time increase simultaneously, so you lose causality. And again, it's important for video, for human inspection. And there are several modes of usage. One is, you can say, well, I have 3 minutes. That's all I have. Show me everything you can show me in 3 minutes. After this, I have a meeting with my girlfriends. I cannot wait any longer. Or I must see anything. Give me anything, everything that is in the video in the shortest possible time. And these are the modes. And again, as I mentioned, everything points back to the original timing. This can serve as a presentation layer for whatever analysis, computer analysis we have of the video. So before I talk about that, the detail of video synopsis, I'll talk about playing in time, that actually was the work before this. So playing in time, look at the forum. Assume I started working on mosaicing, and we always took a video like this and mosaic it together, so this is a mosaic of the video on the left. But when you look at the video, you see something is missing. What is missing on the mosaic of the video? The wind. There's no wind. And the question is, could we put the wind on the mosaic that we do here? Well, of course we can, because you see. But then, what do we have to do in order to do this? And this is very, very tricky, because on the original video, we see the shadows. And only after 5 seconds or 10 seconds, we see the branches that cast this shadow. Here, we see the shadow and the branch together. So time changed. What happened from the left to the right? In addition to the change of space of mosaicing, we screwed up time. Time is not chronological anymore, because objects that appear at different times appear together on the right. So this notion of non-chronological time was the large gap between the mosaicing that we've known for many years and then the mosaicing of the dynamic landscape trees on the right. Because we all try to keep on our time chronological. If things happen one after the other, we should always do that. And the minute you want to keep time chronological, there's many things you cannot do. Only when you give up the notion of chronological time, you can get such effect of mosaicing. And there's another one, this is Iguazu Falls between Brazil and Argentina. Everyone take a picture of the falls. You can mosaic in the frozen falls, but you can mosaic it with this type of mosaic. So you both panoramas and water flowing. Of course, we've never seen originally this water and this water flowing together. We show them again many seconds apart. In the video, we could do many.
So the reason you have to do that, you have seven sweeps of the sea?
No, one.
That's one sweep.
One sweep. One sweep of the sea. And then the way it's done as follows. So we take the video, we take the motion of the camera, we align the motion of the camera. Basically, the orange part here is the space time volume. This is X in integer, leaving the integer, this is time. And first, we take mosaic. This is most described mosaic. We take the right part of all the images. So all the images are mentioned on the right part. Right part is going to just enter the video. And then we move this, we do a sequence of mosaic. Each mosaic takes from a different part. Then send mosaic from the center. Then mosaic from the left. The left is every part is just going to exit the video. So new different mosaic. Each mosaic taken from a different time of the drop of water, say. So in the first mosaic, the drop of water is in the top, in the second mosaic, the drop of water in the middle, and the last mosaic, the drop is in the bottom. So that's what we get flow, and the angle of this curve is basically the difference, the marking time and space are kind of being traded, this difference of time and space. And now we're not in relativity theory, that's for the division. But it's some interesting effect. For example, the same video, camera moving from left to right, the same one, the camera moving from right to left. Well, first thing you think about, how do I make a camera moving left to right, moving from right to left? Just play the video backwards. Okay, so this is the video played backwards, the camera moving from right to left, but the water also is going from the bottom. That's not possible. So using this temporal effect, you can have both the camera going from right to left and the water flowing down. So I must tell you that this simple thing, it takes minutes to write in MATLAB and it took me 2 weeks to think about how this is done. But, okay, so what we are doing, we take a video. So this is a video, a set of frames organized at 3D, X, Y, and T. And every mosaic is basically a manifold cutting through this pack of frames. So this is one output frame. And if you want to generate a video, we just move this manifold and you get another frame and another frame. So if the camera is static, for example, this is the first manifold, it's just one frame, one of the original frame. And slowly the new frames, every curve like this is an output frame, and then at the end the output frame has pixels from many frames that came out at different times. So this is basically all the notion of dynamic mosaic, and when I say I show a curve like this, it means this curve cuts pixels, all the pixel cuts are being output as the output image. And if it goes between pixels, we interpret it. I give you an example. This is a video of demolition. There's a company that does demolition of buildings. This is King Tom in Seattle, was demolished some years ago. And this company puts on the web all the building demolitions. It's, if you like destructions, this is the website to go with. Tons of videos of demolitions. And the bad thing about this destruction, the good thing actually, it's all the structures goes on very uniformly together. Now assume that we want the dome to go down first. in the sunlight. Or the ciphers of the building, they're flat, the building is gone. I mean, it's a real building, real structure that went down clouds of dust. But we cannot do it again because the building is gone, but we can do post-processing. How can we do post-processing? Playing with the time frame. For example, if we take, this is basically a cut in the space number. So these are the frames. This is start with a little smoke and then this is time. A lot of smoke at the end. And we mosaic, this is the image. The image that we get is a set of taken from the future time and the side from the past. So the side are taken from the past, the center from the future. And if we run this, so in the image we generate this image. So see, this is the top is falling first and then the sides are falling. Or if you want the sides to fall first, with the top is it the sides from the future and the center from the past. So we run this through this takeoff video and we have the sides fall first and then the top falls. So it's kind of very easy to get effects at the time. But we can do even more interesting things. For example, assume this is swimming competition. Can we decide who's winning the competition? No problem. This is again, this is the space time volume, just kind of look for that on the space time volume. And these are the slices. So we start with the original frame, and then the next frame in the mosaic takes one swim a little ahead in time, and then a little more in time. At the end, this swim really takes ahead, goes ahead in time. So if you play the video, remember the original video, there was no winner, and here there's a very clear winner. It's this guy that he made his time run faster. And we have a friend, we want our friend to win as well, let his time run faster. So now this guy is. So the minute that we give up the notion of chronological time, we can play with time, it's nice, interesting thing. We tried to convince, there was one of the Olympics, and Panasonic was making the video cameras there and distribution. So Panasonic kind of, look, you can have this and you can transmit to every country that their acrobat or their team is winning. And why don't you do this? Everyone on Earth will be happy because everyone will be winning. They refuse to do this. And say, if they do this, no one will believe what they see in the video anymore. So the world is not as happy as it could have been. Okay, now we go back to surveillance. As we mentioned, we have tons of cameras, more and more cameras. The number is growing. And we mentioned that not enough people to watch video. Basically, most videos never watched. What is that? So the two approaches. One approach is the keyframes. I mentioned collection of either keyframes or collection sentences. Some people will say, this is a work in a Microsoft that's similar to our work, but it's more general to our work, therefore it's really useless because it doesn't preserve space. Anyway, so what we propose is object-based summary that will enable to show a long video in a short way without fast forward. So we don't, I will do fast forward just to run things faster here, but the method itself does not involve fast forward. It doesn't involve moving object in time. And what we get, as we show you, we get a long video, 24 hours. We take all the objects that appear in 24 hours, show them together in as short time as we can. Here, for example, it's 1 minute. And if we want to see what happened originally with an object, we can just select it and go back to original. So the idea is simple. We have a space-time going. This is our video. We have different objects originally appeared at different time. We just, in the output video, we push them to appear together. That's all that we do. And kind of a more pictorial way, so there is original object, original video, we select object for the video, each object has its original time. Once we want to watch the video, we select the object of interest, put them simultaneously, you know, they appear at different time, and let them play. So this is an example again of original video. And this on the bottom is the example of the summary. Everything pulled out from all time shown. So what are the steps? First is the detection of tracking of object and putting data. This is simple. Assumption is the camera is stationary and everything that moves is of interest. We track and put in database. I say it's simple, it's really the simplest thing in all video analysis, the backup subtraction class. Still, it's no way so. We have dark people moving at night, it's hard to track. If you look at video like this in snow, it's impossible to do anything when there's snow. So it's still a lot of work to do, but among everything in the analysis of surveillance cameras, this is the most solved issue. Then object selected, relevant objects are selected from the database and are placed in synopsis where objects from different time appear together. Now metadata, which object may have metadata done by some kind of other processes, can be used to sort the synopsis object. Yes.
So how do you deal with overlapping of
You mean overlapping at the analysis case or the synthesis?
Like it's a subject that is passing over other, so it looks like they have a mask or anything because it's not like a bonding box covering other.
Oh, you mean in this in the detection tracking stage?
Yes.
Well, common filter does it. So if common filter goes there, so if one common filter goes one direction, another common filter goes the other direction, you can realize that. That would be the problem.
But you have like a segmentation of the object itself, or
it's you segment the object at the beginning, and then you know the object does not change in size too much. So if two objects occlude each other, then the size can be bigger. You know, but some two objects collide, then you have to decide which of them go where. So you start with filter. These are.
So this tracking method is your own method.
No. Nothing. It's somebody else. We just. Well, what means somebody else? You take something from the web, you read papers, then you know if it doesn't work, so take your time to adjust the parameters. But the essential thing is not something that we did. We did just tweaking the parameters.
The occlusion and things, so you have some motion model which cameras that are using big things.
Yeah. It's a simple common computer and we have some assumptions that the object do not change sizes too much, too fast, and they don't change color and appearance too fast. And I think that everyone uses them. It works quite well. So we mentioned how do we do this backup subtract. So we build a color distribution for each pixel. And for example, it can be a histogram of color values that normally appear. And if you see a color with a low probability based on the histogram, you know it's a foreground. That's a normal thing about backup subtraction. One thing is, how do you keep the probabilities in the histogram if you can make sure Gaussian view? Basically, some methods work better in some other cases. There is no one winning method. Actually, tons of other good methods are there as source for Google.
So
this is the detection, then we do the tracking. The detection tells you anything that is different from the background. The tracking, you want to track objects that look similar. We use common filter. So we have location, motion, words that were predicted next. We compare the appearance of the object. The appearance is actually the pixels, the value of the pixel, the object, and object to be similar every frame to the other, etc. So we combine both background subtraction and tracking together.
So the color, this is done offline. Once you have one video, this is offline, right?
What is offline?
You would assume the one video is available.
Okay, so that two is initially what we thought. without to do the follow-up. We have a video. This thing is, workshop subtraction is easy. It can be done 10 times in real time, 10 times faster than real time. So we said, let's run, like we have 10 cameras, let's run the 10 cameras through PC and do all the object tracking and put it on disk. And when you want something, you correct. But then we realize that people don't care about most of the video. So most of the video you do, you detect and track object, no one ever look at it. So let's do it offline. Let's start to do detection of tracking object only once people are interested in one particular video. Because otherwise it's a waste of time to do the detection of tracking. This is most of the work. Most of the work is to take a video and extract these people. So this is an example of two objects. So this is two objects as video clips, or if we collapse the object on, collapse the time and into one frame, so this is how one object look like. And
if we are going to use the whole video, then it's getting cubes to make a difference from the just few frames in the detection.
But basically we look at the entirety, we look at everything that of the object. So we, but again, we do it offline because most of the video no one is watching, so it's a lot of waste of energy to analyze all the video, and essentially people will just look at 1/10 of 1% of the video.
Yeah.
If
I'm looking for a criminal and I assume that the bottom picture have all the people who were playing billiard at that time, but I lost the time frame that this criminal shows up at that place. Is it lost or?
No, because every object, basically, what's an object? An object is a tube plus the link. You know exactly what time this object played. So if you see something, you stop, you click on the object, you get it was 2 a.m., you go to the video, play 2 a.m. video, and you see the original video. So it's like an index. Index makes no sense, but the index tells you this is page 15, page 15, so you can go back to the page and see the context. And actually, we had another question. What question that we had when you look at this video? When you look at this video, how easy it is to find what you want? Maybe it's not easy at all. Too many objects, too loaded, too much information. So actually, the FBI bought it. But before the FBI bought it, they made a study. They took the method, they analyzed the video. For 2 months, they studied, will people get to the suspect faster using this method than by watching the original video? Now, the FBI is one-way information. They don't tell you anything. But the result was they did purchase the system. So the assumption is that they found it useful, otherwise they wouldn't have purchased the system. OK. So after we have object detection tracking, basically, so this is the original video, and these are the detected objects on top. We just play Tetris and basically pack the object in time to be as dense as possible, and trying to minimize the overlap. If we could be actually playing very dense, but then object on the display will go over each other, and then we won't be able to understand anything. So we want it to be as dense as possible, but not on top of each other. What does it mean? Everything in computer vision goes into equations. So basically, we want to do as much object will appear simultaneously. On the other hand, we want this is no collision. So no object would overlap other object. Not no, but if all object overlap each other, then we get a penalty. To say no, it's too strong, and then sometimes we want temporal consistency. So if we can show object and the original order without making the summary number, we prefer object to be the original order. So basically, we have some kind of elements in the equation. So this element make it short. This element make sure that the minimize overlap, and this element says that it favors a temporal consistency, and we have to minimize this, reorder the object, minimize this, We have several methods to do it. We found, when we wrote the paper, we used simulated annealing. Later we found other methods to minimize it. Of course, you cannot minimize it, find a global minimum, but only approximation. So some kind of eventual distance reader video where an object comes from the left and then another, when I say object, it's a student, of course, come from the right, and then the student comes from the left and goes. So basically we have these three students, these three tracks. What will be the optimal packing? The optimal packing being nesting this one inside this one, optimal packing without occlusion, without intersection. Nesting this inside and playing this sideways to this one. So this is what will make this one way short, no occlusion, and but of course no temporal consistency. And the result is this, that the student is coming, while she is coming, the student on the left is coming, the student on the right is coming, and everything happens, but not on the right order. Now I mentioned, what happens if you have one object? So this is the case with several other objects placed simultaneously. What happens if we have objects that are very long, longer than the summary, and then we can break them and create some of this. This is this case. So one long object can be broken into several parts and placed simultaneously. So here again, the issue is how to break it, and the breaking is done to minimize the previous equation.
So when you break, when you put these together, do you have problem with artifacts?
Of course. We'll talk about this later.
Okay.
And we can do about, if you have a panning camera, we can do together, but this on top of a mosaicing. So we create a mosaic background, and we can take this center and show it shorter in five copies or four. I'm always confused. After I play, I cannot count. Okay, one thing is the background. How do we show the background? So, if they're very short videos, we can take one still image of a clean background. It only if we take a day, the background is can start this way, and then go to this, go to this, and then so the background changes during the day. So what we normally do for the background is use fast forward on the background. So the background will take every thousandth frame of the background to put it. So, and you notice here that here the background has cars. What does it mean that the background has cars? It means that the car is parked here longer than, say, half an hour once it becomes part of the background. So the background is not only at the parking lot of the building, but also cars that happen to park a long time and then they become part of the background. And when we look at background, we see, for example, this is distribution of objects in the over time, and this is basically the background we use. We use some background which is light, some background that is day, some. What you see, this is kind of a fast forward of the. Of the background, of the 24-hour background, you see like we have almost no activity at night. Most activity is between 8 a.m. and 8 p.m. No activity between 8 p.m. to 8 a.m. in the morning. So that's I guess a shopping center, some shopping mall, and no one there is at night. And therefore we can use more of the daytime background than the nighttime background. And the issue is the stitching. Whatever the stitching is, because we mix them together, we have a background from one time, we have an object on top from different time. For example, this is an object taken from one time, I think it's a day, pasted on a night time background. Usually we paste day or night because there's a lot of empty space at night. So we see that the background is different, so we do blending. You know, to overcome this, we do blending. What we did here was some blending. And you see this is the way that happens in the blending. and this is another example. So he would put a lot of objects in the background, and you can see this is before blending, after blending. So after blending, it really looks as if everything happens at the same time, lighting condition of the background. So this, without blending, you get a lot of side effect that it's hard to look in the video, because you see kind of all the seams and high frequencies of the stitching, and it really bothers you. But once the blending takes care of all these. And then one thing I want to show is actually the link. So this is a original video, this is the synopsis. See? This is the same talking, but this is the synopsis. It's very busy, but of course it's never busy this way. This is an example of the synopsis, and we see this is a frame from the synopsis, and we see that for these three objects are from different times. You can see this by the shadows. So this is a long shadow when I was in the morning or in the evening. This is no shadow at all, meaning it may be cloudy time, and this shadow is just, I believe, when this is a noon time. So they come from different times, and we want to show them how they really work, because they came from different times. So we select this person. This is the person in the original video. This is this card in the original video. And this is the cards. Anyway, so we can actually select the object. Once we select the object, every object has a time in the original video. We can go back to the original video. So as a system, basically, we can have a system of cameras. And instead of now being able to see the synopsis, I want to show two use cases. One case actually is a shop that installed this, and this shop and the case that do you see my finger here? So this car, the owner of this car, came to the security guy. He told him, I was here shopping. When I went to the car, I saw that someone bumped into my car, hit my car. You have video on the parking lot, show me the video, I want to find this guy. I said, how much? How about working in the sometimes it's just an hour and a half. And this guy thinks, well, I'm not going to watch an hour and a half video, but the guy just bought the system before, so okay, we have the summary. And he decided to play the summary of the hour and a half. So you see this finger? So look at the finger, and then you see that now there's no one else coming, probably boom. Okay? So it took him 15 seconds to find the car. Now he could follow the car to the parking lot. So he and the lady ran out to the parking lot, and they found the hitting car parked there, waiting for the owner, and asked the owner to pay for this damage. So it's not that you have to wait days and do this. It's even something that is almost alive. Instead of waiting hours, you can do it in a few minutes. It helps use the information in the video. Okay, let's keep it up like that. Let's keep here. I was giving speed time. Okay, well, this is a measure. See, if one of the important things that I'll talk about later is the similarity. We want to find similar objects. What does similar object mean? So similar object means objects that have similar trajectory, and this is mentioned here. Similarity, you take like the two trajectories and find what is the minimum area that is locked between the two trajectories. We can have similar color, similar shape. We do about using kind of a collection of six descriptors. One example I want to show is being able to use the synopsis in a Google-like manner. Google-like manner, when you look for something, you order the relevance, and you show the most relevant first, and then the less relevant later, and you go from first page, second page, third page, until you give up. And hopefully you find everything on the first page, but who knows. So this is a original video of one of the universities, maybe in the US, I'm not sure. And this is a original video. So it's a message, not too many students. And from time to time, a bicycle goes by. this is a synopsis, so it takes all the objects from all the day in 23 minutes, so it's very, very crowded. But it's crowded not because it's crowded, just because all the objects came from different times. Now, so this is a normal synopsis, just taking all the objects on it simultaneously. Now, we simply want to sort them, to see what are the fastest moving objects. So these are the fastest moving objects, and then slowly we add slower objects. So bicycles are the fastest here, there's no crowding present. Some cars that happen to be as fast as bicycles. Then we'll see skateboards. Actually, I've seen here people on this campus moving the skateboard. Then running people, then walking people, then crawling people, but and we can order them by speed. You can order by other types. Find all the red people, all the people that are red. Well, you know, red is not well defined. In every camera, red looks different. But so what we can do is order. So this is a person with a lot of red, simply closer to the red than purple. And the more we wait, the less red we see with the people. And originally see the people with a lot of red. I don't know what she said, she has no way to go, but again, the Google search also, you can find everyone in the first page. But then as you wait, more and more people of no red show up to OXCM. So just all we use the metadata just as a way to sort the objects there. And the interesting is the very similar to you point an object and you ask, find me an object similar to this one. Okay? What are this? That's a girl, short, walking in this direction. So you see, I don't know why I picked up girls, but I can understand this direction, okay, because the similar skin. Probably the color, skin color, calls up a lot of a girl with shorts. And then as time go by, we now start to see people with different people, but all born the same. You see that originally we were the most similar to the one we selected and then less than the similar. Of course, we can refine. You say, okay, similar to this, but very not similar to this. So throughout all the
group, similar is going
to be the data objective? Well, similar is based on the metadata that we have on hand. In this case, the metadata we have on hand was color, was shape for six descriptors, and was a trajectory. So it kind of a weighted combination of all three. What are the weights? I don't remember, but we can learn the weights, of course, by pointing to something like this, and so not like this, more like that, and you can basically do a scale of questions. And actually, I will end here. I'll ask to end at 2:50, so I think I just did that. And if you have a question, you can very good.
How can we manipulate those things?
Excuse me?
How can we manipulate those things in that job? How do you do this? How do you pick a friend and put them in one video? How can you do that?
Matter. Yeah. That's true, isn't it? It's easy. Everything is matter. Well, everything was developed with matter. In order for this to run at FBI, someone went through rewriting everything and
he wants you to give him a quote.
The funny thing is, you don't have to look at the matter code because, you know, it's a read once code, write once or something that's unreadable. And the C code is a conversion with the company that does it, so hopelessly.
Yeah, Christian, yeah. If you created a tube, which is kind of like a cropping of each object, that's an automatic process.
Yeah. Everything is automatic. Except, everything is automatic except the Lamana says if you want to select. Show me the red, show me this. This is, you select what you want or go make the region. Otherwise, everything is automatic.
Yeah, go ahead. If you have a camera, I mean, is it too bad or it's kind of nice?
If you have a camera moving, yes. It's a, the two bad things about moving objects. One is that it's much harder to detect and track moving objects. Sure, not track, but mostly detect a moving object. But before we assume that everything is stationary, if you move, you are a moving object. When you're moving camera, everything moves. Then you have to be much smarter to decide what is background and what's moving object. This is one thing. And most of the tracking methods assume that you have a method of pointing to, for example, assume you're looking for people. So you have a person detector and you mark a person and you get the person. And if it's not a person, it's not there. Then comes the output. How do you show the results? We show the results of different times, from different times on the same background. If the background changes, how do you show the same background? So if the camera is moving a little bit to light or mosaic, you can do that. But if the camera is just going from one place to another, for example, Google Glass, you wear something, or GoPro on your head, and you go from one place to another, the paper completely different. Not that clear. I mean, we're working on this. We're trying to think how do we summarize moving cameras. But it's not clear how to do that, because the background changes, and you cannot mix objects from different times. It means that you mix objects from different backgrounds. And you don't know how to show on what background.
This thing on multiple view cameras, what do you mean? Like, same scene but viewing from multiple angles that might have more information and you can easily segment the object.
We are trying to do this on not necessarily the same field of view, but assume that you're a supermarket, you know, entry camera and exit camera. And we try to correlate the people coming in and people going out. And show a summary that on the entrance camera and the exit camera, you will see the same people at the same time. So that if you see someone coming in with no bags, someone coming out with a lot of bags, but you didn't go for the checkout, the cash register, then it should be checked. But it's not easy because there are multiple views. Normally we see, actually I learned this at the workshop with Professor Shah a couple of days ago. This is since we have more eyes, we look at the video, our brain can understand one stream of video. Because with one pair of eyes, we always look at one thing. If we have shown several things together, we're lost. We cannot either show this and show that. We cannot simultaneously show several. So there should be a way to show it in one view, but we don't know. Other one?
One question I have, you showed that your energy initiation the length of the tube was preserved. What about subsampling to make sure it's shorter in case the person is doing certain motion that is repetitive or you don't care about, and you care about a certain specific action? What about kind of reducing that length of the tube?
Yeah, this is this could be very useful if you have, for example, one of the cases that you said, you have a camera in a supermarket, you have the cashier. The cashier is there all the time doing repetitive stuff. You really don't care. If you would like to see the cashier, then a day video will remain a day video. You cannot show it. You don't really care. I don't know. So it's really scenario specific. So in the cash register, for example, you just segment out. See, just take the cashier. I don't care about this region. But this is specific for this. It'd be much nicer, as you mentioned, to see repetitive activity rather than showing all the repetitive activity all the time, just so one instance of this activity and not waste the time of the case. But it can be done, it should be done. Yeah, go ahead.
So, about the first part of your talk on manipulating and assuming contents for the collapsing building, do you know whether people in the movie industry, specifically in visual effects, have used such kind of things? Because right now they do it with computers, some 3D people and graphics. But this shows that it can be used to create movies. Do you know whether people have done this?
Not this method, but people have done similar things. For example, they took videos from different time and do what's called like photo montage, video montage. So sometimes you'll see videos that are taken different time on that. Well, everything is manually. Nothing like, you know, specific, whatever. Everything is done manually, a lot of work.
and not this one.
We don't have that, but there's overlap in objects. I mean, in some places there are maybe too many people working together, so are they considered to be one object?
No. Every person is different object. Well, it's interesting. If two people hug each other, walk through the video, remain hugged, and live, you can consider them as one person, one object. But if they start walking nearby each other, and then one goes to the left, one to the right, they're different. So,
Maybe in some places, like Times Square or something, there are too many people, so all of them may be considered population.
Well, I mean, if you want to track individual people in crowd, I think this is the place, right? So, but yeah, it's difficult. The idea, of course, because we're doing like object-based summarization, we want to fit in our object. So we'd like every object in life to be different object also in our video. So as much as possible, if a different person, we want to have a different object. So we can, if we want only boys, only girls, and we want to, if we want to be able to separate them, we cannot put two people together and call them as one. But it's difficult, right? Not always easy.
Yeah, go ahead. So how crowded do you make your video synopsis? Is that a parameter of your system? Like,
yeah.
You guys can put everything
It's together? A parameter. The slider, and as crowded as you can bear. So basically, it's up to the viewer. If you're busy and you don't have time, you can crowd it. If you want to see every little detail, you make it less long. So it's a parameter. It's basically, in the cost function, it's the weight of the occlusion. So if the occlusion has a very strong weight, every small occlusion really kills your cost function, then you'll be sparse. If you allow some occlusions, then it'll be denser.
So when you play this video, you play 30 frames per second, or you play it faster?
No, we play the same speed.
So one thing will be that if you play them slowly, slower, then maybe more easier for people.
Yeah, one of the things we try to think about is it is basically equalized, like, you know, in images, one of the enhancers equalized histogram. This equalized the speed. Mm-hmm. So try to take the object, an object that moves fast, and then confuse, make it slow motion. Mm-hmm. An object go very, very slow, speed them up a little. So this is all objects move at a similar speed. And then actually also the synopsis is much more efficient, because if objects are the same speed, you can really compact them better without overlapping each other. But we haven't done that yet. So,
the last question, Shayan.
So for the video mosaic that you create, for example, if the video is 5 seconds and in the last 3 seconds you don't see the bottom at all, the video that you showed, the whole video was moving for the whole time. So how do you do that? Do you repeat?
No, the mosaic is shorter than the original video. The original video is a certain time. Well, what we do in the mosaic, we trade time for space. The angle is trading time for space. It means that it has more space because we see the panorama, but it has less time. So depending on the angle, you get more time, less space, more space, less time. So we pay more space for the time that we save, but it is shorter. The mosaic is shorter than the original video.
Yes, but it's still when you go up and you're looking at like the top part of the view, you don't have anything at the bottom. So yeah. How that's still moving?
I'm happy to explain to you, but I heard many people here lecture at three, so okay. I should
finish. Okay, thank you.